Hello, fellow scholars, and welcome back to another episode of Eberron Historian. Today, we'll be taking an in-depth look at one of Eberron's most iconic features, its unique modes of transport, such as the lightning rail, the airship, and the elemental galleon. Before we get started, don't be afraid to hit those like and subscribe buttons. The channel is growing, and the more fellow scholars we attract, the more time I can dedicate to producing these videos. Let us begin. Early in the 9th century YK, almost 100 years before the last war, House Caneth came together with the talented artificers from the nation of Zalago. Together, they began developing a method for harnessing the power of bound elementals and using their energy to power locomotion in large vehicles. The process they pioneered involved using varying esoteric techniques, taking months to infuse a vessel's hull with magic energy and rare resources. The result was unveiled in the year 811 YK, when Corvair witnessed the birth of its first lightning rail, connecting the cities of Flamekeep and Fairhaven. A testament to the arcane brilliance of House Caneth and the Gnomes of Zalago, the lightning rail is a multi-carriage vehicle which travels along a track consisting of diamond-shaped conductor stones, which are interspersed at regular intervals. The rail itself also has a series of conductor stones embedded in the bottom of its hull. It is the repulsion between the stones on the track and rail which caused the vessel to hover around 5 feet in the air, whilst propulsion is provided by the bound lightning elemental on board, which causes electricity to arc between the vessel and the track, giving it its namesake. There are two rare and vital components that are required for the binding of the elementals. The first is a large Kyber dragon shard, within which the elemental will be bound. The second is a Sabirus dragon shard, which is used to craft a helm with which the vessel's conductor or pilot can communicate with and control the bound elemental. Kyber dragon shards are usually found in seams deep underground, in some of the most dangerous parts of the inner world, while Sabirus dragon shards are found in rare meteorites that fall from the ring of crystal that encompasses the world of Eberron. The Kyber dragon shard holding the elemental is placed within a containment chamber within the forward locomotive, from where the elemental can emerge and flow along an invisible arcane matrix woven throughout the vehicle like veins and arteries. From there, the elemental is forced through binding struts, which cause it to take a particular shape according to the vehicle's needs. A lightning rail struts, for example, simply cause the lightning elemental to stretch along the length of the train and bounce between the conductor stones. The helm can take many different forms, such as a wheel with Sabirus dragon shards embedded along the edges, a dragon shard inlaid helmet, or simply a dragon shard orb. Use of such a helm requires the talent of a dragon-marked heir of House Orion that bears the mark of passage, or a House Lirandar heir with the mark of storms, depending on the vehicle. Without a dragon mark and the required training, control of the elemental on board can be very difficult, but not always impossible. A talented magic user could also influence the elemental using spells such as Dominate or Charm Monster. The connection between Fairhaven and Flamekeep was just the beginning. King Jarrett, the ruler of Gallifar at the time, began a project to connect all of Central Corvair using the lightning rail. At this time, House Orion had already begun establishing their dominion of overland transit, and so King Jarrett looked to them to spearhead the project. House Orion commissioned a group known as the Trailblazers, who set out to establish the many routes of the lightning rail and lay the conductor stones that would be required. Within 20 years, a network was established connecting all five nations of Gallifar, which at the time encompassed Zalago, the Maror Holds, and the Talenta Plains. For over a century, House Orion had a monopoly on overland transport and postal services. But as the last war began in 894 YK, disruptions to the lightning rail network would become common, and House Caneth began looking to the skies. In the year 980 YK, at the height of the last war, House Caneth and the artificers of Zalago would unveil their latest, and so far greatest development in transport, the elemental airship. Powered by a bound fire or air elemental in the same way as the lightning rail, the airships are constructed using an extremely rare material called sawwood, which is native to the continent of Erinel, and to date hasn't been found anywhere else on Eberron. Sawwood is a highly buoyant timber, which when properly treated with the right arcane methods, will take on a property of being lighter than air, whilst still maintaining the strength of the sturdiest hardwood. The elves of Erinel have placed a limit on the amount of sawwood that is harvested and exported annually, and thus the manufacture of airships is slow, and only a small amount of them have actually been produced in the time since. Like the lightning rail, a dragon-marked air is required to properly control the airships. However, it is the mark of storms that bestows the appropriate talent for piloting the airships, and for the first time in a century, House Orion's monopoly over the transport business came under threat. Although few in number, the utility of being able to fly anywhere without the constraints of a track put the airships at the top as the most efficient and expensive way to travel and transport goods. Of course, there was immediate demand from the Five Nations to weaponize and use the airships on the warfront, but House Lirandar would initially refuse, as the airships were so few in number, and no price paid by a warring nation could compensate if any were destroyed in battle. After a great deal of pressure, House Lirandar eventually relented, and in the year 994 YK, a handful of weaponized airships, dubbed Storm Ships, were produced, and their services made available to the war effort. An airship's propulsion system is very similar to the lightning rails. It uses the same dragon shard helm and containment system, and a similar elemental matrix. However, the binding struts stick out at diagonal angles from the hull, and the elemental is forced into a ring which surrounds the vessel. When a ship's elemental is dormant, it maintains its buoyancy thanks to the sawwood hull, and due to the nature of the protruding binding struts, an airship never lands on the ground. Sky docks were built on towers in cities where the airships make port, and droppable rope ladders can be used in emergency situations or times when a sky dock is unavailable. Following the last war and the day of mourning, elemental airships found increased utility and demand, as they are the most efficient way of bypassing the Mornlands, which now separates Corvair's east and west. House Orion and House Lirandar are now in fierce competition for dominion over the transport business, but House Lirandar maintains a strong upper hand, particularly with their developments in sea transport. Using the same propulsion and strut design, House Caniff have applied the technology to more traditional seafaring galleon, which have no need for sawwood in the manufacturing process and are more freely created. They are powered by a bound water elemental, and are also controlled by a dragon-marked heir of House Lirandar. In the year 987 YK, the nation of Brelan faced a sudden threat from the west, when the denizens of Dram were united by the daughters of Sorakel and declared their sovereignty. The rugged terrain surrounding the Greywall Mountains restricted the movement of the Brelish forces, as there were no roads to bring in wagons of fresh supplies and troops. In response, House Caniff and Orion employed the same techniques they used to develop their other vehicles and applied it to a new form of overland transport that would harness the power of bound earth elementals. The resulting vehicle was dubbed the Earth Sled, a troop and cargo transport similar to a barge that glides upon the earth on four protruding struts that are carried and propelled by a bound earth elemental that glides just below the earth's surface. With crew and cargo properly secured, the sled could even traverse up and down sheer mountain surface and through shallow waters. It is theorized that the sleds could even traverse underwater on river and lake bed, although a crew would have to be able to somehow deal with the lack of air. Since the end of the war, House Orion has made their earth sleds available for hire to anyone needing to travel across unpaved countryside. Of all the vehicles developed by the artificers of Zalago, one of the oddest and scarcely seen is the Tumbler. Originally developed by Zalago as a means to carry miners to remote caverns within the earth, the Tumbler has since been sold in limited numbers to various governments across Corvair for use in espionage and shock warfare. From the outside, a Tumbler has the appearance of a large sphere of rock with a long seam around its circumference. The seam opens like a hatch, revealing room inside for up to 12 people. Once closed, the tumbler traverses by rolling along the surface, although the interior of the vessel and its occupants constantly remain upright, while a set of stationary windows, made out of crystal, also provide the passengers a view of the outside. The tumbler's movement is all powered by a bound earth elemental, which even allows it to burrow through the earth itself, just as the elemental's earth glide ability. Whilst underground, the air inside the cabin is cycled by a second bound air elemental, which keeps the atmosphere breathable for up to 10 days without surfacing. The tumbler's earth glide leaves no tunnel or trace of shifted earth in its wake, making it an invaluable tool for any espionage or stealth operation. There are many other methods of transport available in the world of Eberron, from more traditional methods such as House Orion's famous overland wagon carriages to instantaneous transport via their teleportation circles. But these will be covered in a more in-depth look at House Orion in a future installment of Eberron Historian. Thank you for watching, everyone. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I have a long list of subjects I want to cover in the future, but if you have anything you'd like to add to it, please comment it below. Shout out to my patrons, Michael, Justin, and Mick. If you would like to help keep the lights on whilst also picking up some awesome music and maps of my own creation, please consider stopping by my Patreon, link below. As always, you can find me live streaming a few times a week at twitch.tv/TalesofPesh. And don't forget to check out Exploring Eberron by Keith Baker, available from dmsguild.com, link in the description below. Thank you very much, and I will see you next time.